Good morning. You have a lecture about photodiagnosis. I would like to introduce Cristina Kurashi from University of São Paulo, São Carlos, Brazil. Thank
you. Bom dia, good morning, everybody. I am a dentist, but I have been working at the physics department since 1998, and I'm going to present today a summary of what we have been doing in fluorescence diagnosis, and somehow our experience doing this technique, especially for detection of malignant lesions. So I'm going to talk especially of fluorescence spectroscopy, and what we can do and what we can collect the information from this kind of technique to use this to detect lesions. Until a few years ago, this would be somehow a little bit of strange when we call, when we talk about an optical diagnosis. How we could do this kind of detection of a diagnosis using only light, using only a light scanning of a full body. So this would be something amazing until a few years ago. And for instance, we have this science fiction movie, the Star Trek, when the doctor used a laser scan, and so they could monitor the patient's health using only an optical device. And this for us was something really from a science fiction movie. Nowadays, I cannot tell you that we have all the parameters, all the protocols to use this to detect every kind of lesion, every kind of disease, with higher sensitivity and specificity. But we are working on this. A lot of groups around the world are working on this. And I think maybe in a few years from now, we can use this kind of detection for many applications. And as Dr. Vandelay told us yesterday, we have this optical diagnosis in different levels. We can use it for imaging, so especially we for detecting the lesion margins, we can use this kind of fluorescence imaging to help us to delimitate this lesion. We can use at a spectroscopy level, which we will be the main topic of this lecture, trying to collect some information more specifically about the biochemical and the structure of this lesion. And we can also use this optical diagnosis through the microscopy. We can use this to evaluate it at a cell level and detect more the tissue structure. And also, we can do this kind of optical diagnosis using different techniques, as reflectance, and so only that portion of the light that's only scattered at the surface, the fluorescence, HAMA, as Vandelay told us yesterday, and optical coherent tomography. And just to remind us a little bit, what's the fluorescence? When we have the biomolecules and all the tissue structures, they are in a ground state, which is the lowest level energy state of a molecule. And if you give a light to this tissue or to this molecule, light is nothing else as an energy. So you are giving energy to this tissue. So this biomolecule goes to an excited state, And this kind of state is really unstable. The tendency is that this biomolecules goes back to that ground level with a lower energy level. And one of the ways that this tissue can gives back this energy excess is through a light emission, which is so the fluorescence. And this kind of energy decay is really specific to each kind of biomolecule. So that's why we can detect and we can distinguish these biomolecules through the analysis of this light emission. And we know that this region of the electromagnetic spectrum, we have a higher energy wavelength. So usually we use for this kind of analysis wavelengths that are in this part of the visible region, especially around the 400 nanometers until the blue part of the spectrum. And we are going to collect the fluorescence light more in this region. So usually we use an wavelength with a higher energy in this lower part here, and we are going to collect a higher wavelength. And just to illustrate this, we have many applications of this analysis using the fluorescence to monitor some kind of in this case, we are monitoring, we see an example of pollution monitor. This is an image from a satellite. And in this part around, especially the more developed countries, we have a higher fluorescence. This is a false color range here. And in this region, with a higher fluorescence, so in this part it's red, this is a more polluted water, okay? So you can use the fluorescence image to monitor this kind of difference in different samples. And here we see an example of a very nice pictures from a microscope level. Of course, these structures, these cell structures are marked with fluorescent dyes, so we can even monitor or see the cell division. Or in this example, these are epithelial cells, where we can see in blue the nucleus and in green the whole part of the cell membrane, and so on. For biological purposes, we can use the optical diagnostics not only for detect lesion, but also to monitor some metabolic conditions, because in this sense, the tissues can be working in different levels, and it's also possible to follow this kind of conditions through the fluorescence. We can also use this technique to evaluate if the treatment that you are proposing for your patient is having or is presenting a good response, because you can use this to monitor if the lesion is decreasing or it is in a necrosis process. All this kind of biological difference can be monitored by fluorescence. Also for margin delimitation of these lesions. And it can help us to study and to understand more the carcinogenesis process. If you know some proteins that are important in the first phase of carcinogenesis, you can use by antibody interaction a fluorescence dye to mark this kind of protein, and then you can follow in a more pre-clinical or in early stage of these lesions. And also you can use this kind of technique to monitor and to follow the pharmacokinetics of the photosensitizers for photodynamic therapy, because they are very good fluorescence dyes. So this is just a diagram showing what we can, how this can be done. We have here a tissue, and we give this tissue energy through the light. We have different kind of interactions here inside the tissues, and part of this light will be transmitted through this tissue, through this tissue layers. Part is going to be absorbed by some biomolecule. In this case, especially the hemoglobin, which has a higher absorption here. And part of this energy, after all this kind of interactions takes place in this tissue, can be the tissue can respond with this fluorescence light. If we collect this kind of light that is coming out from the tissue, we can have some information about the structure and also what is composing this tissue that you are going to evaluate. And this is just a picture to us to visualize what is the fluorescence. Here we have a porphyrin solution. This is a photogen solution. And you see that we are here giving a green light to this solution. We even see the scattering of this green light just behind this cuvette. And if you saw on the top of this cuvette, we can see in this light path that appears some red light here. This is the fluorescence, because the porphyrin likes to absorb the green light, and there are two very specific bands of this porphyrin in the red part of the spectrum. And we are seeing this forming here. In the tissue, respond very similar, okay? Because you can give the light to this tissue and at the same time collect the fluorescence that will be remitted by this tissue. So it's a response at real time that we call. And when you use this kind of technique for biological purpose, for tissue diagnosis, we are going to do this only for superficial lesions, because when you use the around this region of the excitation, we are going to have only tissue penetration to the first layers of the biological tissue. So we are going to do this kind of a diagnosis, especially for skin and for mucosas, where we have a direct access to this investigation probe, and also that is going to be penetrated by the light. If you are going to use this kind of technique for a lesion that is below the surface, you have to do to put the fiber inside this tissue. So you have to use this as an interstitial technique, but you can also do. But one of the major advantages of this optical biognosis, it is that it's a non-invasive technique. So you can You just put in contact the investigation probe to the tissue. You don't have to insert, or you don't have to cut or to remove some part of this tissue. And this is a representation. You have here a tissue, and it is composed by different kinds of biomolecules. Some of them, here I am represent as the little sun, as some absorbers in these tissues, and some other biomolecules are just, or you'll be function only as a scatters biomolecules. If you give light to this tissue, this light is going to be absorbed by some biomolecules. And part of this energy will be give back as light. But you see that some light will be missing inside of this tissue because can be only scattered and depend on the path of this photon, some of this light will be not efficient to go through this tissue layer. So we are going to collect only part of this fluorescent light. Some part of this fluorescent that will be produced inside of this tissue are going to be missing. So we are just having information really, really from the surface. Here is an example of an imaging analysis, and this is following the treatment response, a PDT treatment response, using a topical PDT with ALA. And we see here, before the treatment, we see the lesion, but when you use the fluorescence, the margin delimitation of this lesion is a little bit better if we lose or if you look only by white illumination. After the first PDT session, this is what we can see, that there is a little bit of the lesion behind. So it was the a second PDT procedure was done, and after the second PDT, no more lesion could be evident in this case. This is also an imaging using a UV lamp, a conventional UV lamp. This is one of our patients. And you see that here in this lesion, there is a porphyrin accumulate more if you compare to the normal skin around this lesion. This is the technique that we are going to discuss more. This is some characteristics of this technique. It is also called a point evaluation because you are going to have to collect information or a spectrum from each point that you are evaluating. This is a non-invasive technique and non-descriptive because you don't have to collect a sample and, of this tissue if you compare to the conventional biopsy, that you have to collect some tissue, process this material to look, to have a pathology evaluation. This is a real-time response because in the same time that you are exciting the tissue, we are also collecting the fluorescence. And the result that we have, are you are going to evaluate a graph that gives us the intensity versus the wavelength. So we are going to analyze what is being re-emitted by this tissue. This is just a diagram of this kind of technique, or instrumental of this technique. Usually we use a laser. And there is a probe, a Y-type probe. At one end is connected to this laser. So if we see a section of this probe, we see a central fiber that is going to deliver the excitation light, and six other fibers that are going to collect the remitted light. These six collection fiber are going to the other end of this probe to connect to the spectrometer, and this is going to give us that graph of intensity versus wavelength. We are using this kind of technique to monitor the pharmacokinetics of different photosensitizers, because we know that at clinical use drug light interval for all parts of the body, for all organs, and the pharmacokinetics will be different from patient to patient, and also if you are going to treat a lesion at the leg, of course, the pharmacokinetics or this drug light interval will be different if you are going to treat a lesion at the esophagus, for instance. So you can use this kind of optical diagnosis to determine the best hour for your illumination or the best drug light interval. And we have been doing this in animal models, studying this drug distribution in different parts of the body and for different kinds of organs. This is just an example doing at the automorph of hamsters. This would be presented by a student in the post session. And we have here the determination of the best period for this drug accumulation at the tongue. And in this case, it would be around 8 hours after the systemic administration. And here we see the specific red emission band of this porphyrin. So if we follow this band, this emission band, as the intensity increases, it is an indirect result for us that there is more drug in that tissue. When we use this kind of technique for diagnosis, we have to keep in mind that it's not only the fluorescence that it is contribute for that spectrum. We have to keep in mind that all that light interactions are contribute, also the scattering and also the absorption. And we use this technique for a simple biomolecule or a simple component, it's really easy to analyze the fluorescence spectrum. But if you are doing this for a tissue that is composed by different fluorophores, by different absorbers, this is going to take much more work to do this kind of analysis, because we are collecting all this information together. And of course, this fluorescence spectrum will be dependent not only by the tissue characteristics, the tissue optical characteristics, but also the wavelength, the excitation wave that we are using. Because in this sense, you are excitating different kinds of biomolecules. And this is the most important biomolecules that present fluorescence in the biological tissues. And you see, this is just a summary. There are more structures that are contribute to this fluorescence. And so if you are using this kind of analysis, you have always to remember all this information. And there are a lot of works that has also performed this characteristic of the fluorophores in vitro. So in solution, they detect or they have an excitation emission matrix that you can specifically identify the fluorophore. But this is a result that you have in solution. And when you put this fluorophore in different solutions, change the pH, change the microenvironment condition, this emission, this fluorescence emission is going to change. And of course, if this fluorophore is interacting with another fluorophore or some other absorber, this emission will also change. So we have this specific characteristic fluorescence emission of this fluorophore in solution. But when we are going to do the analysis of the tissue, this is going to change a little bit and may confuse our analysis. This is a result of a student from our group. The black line is just a mathematical processing of that emission of individual fluorophores or the intrinsic fluorescence of each fluorophore in solution. And we just do some processing in the computer, not mixing this fluorophore in solution. And we have this black line here trying to rebuild or trying to have the tissue fluorescence that we collect in an animal model. So the red line is the fluorescence spectrum that we collect from a liver at a rat. And if you do from just adding the fluorescence emission from different fluorophores in solution, we cannot reproduce in a very good way this tissue fluorescence that is collected. So here it's important to say that it is not only the fluorescence that is taking part in this tissue and that is contributing for this final fluorescence. So this work will be presented by Dirceu in the poster session. If someone have more questions about this, you can see more specific in that work. And this is the study that we performed in an animal model, monitoring the fluorescence difference during a carcinogenic process in the tongue of hamsters. So we are trying to evaluate the efficacy of this fluorescence spectroscopy to detect malignant lesion at the tongue, in this case a carcinoma lesion. So we have here for two excitation wavelengths, here in the violet region, 442 nanometers, and here at the green, 532 nanometers. And each line represents a point evaluation at the tongue of this animal. So we have here the fluorescence spectrum of a normal tissue, of a tissue that has not the carcinoma. And here an example of a carcinoma that was chemically produced in this tongue. And here we have the comparison between the normal and here the carcinoma. So we have some points that are similar to the fluorescence from a normal, but we have in some points of these lesions a fluorescence spectrum that is different. The same lesion, but now with excitation at the violet wavelength, and we began to see different emission bands that was not visualized at the normal tissue. So we are having this a change in the wave in the fluorescence behavior. A different kind of lesion. It is also a carcinoma, but with clinical difference here. We have a zoophytic growing and a more advanced carcinoma, and you see that this lesion that is clinically different from the first one, we have here also difference in the fluorescent spectrum. So for the pathologist, this is the same lesion. This is a carcinoma lesion. But here we have a difference depending also at the clinical characteristics. Another kind of lesion, this is the prognosis of this this kind of lesion is a little bit worse because it's a more invasive lesion. And also we have here difference of the fluorescence spectrum, but all of these compared to the normal present some emission bands distinct from the normal. And here is more evident for the blue extension, the violet extension. These emission bands are probably, is probably due to the porphyrins that the malignant tissue produces more compared to the normal one. And if you do a kind of a processing analysis of this spectrum, we can try to give a grade for this lesion. So we want to not only have the visualization of the difference between the spectrum, but we want to have a kind of note for each point of tissue investigation. So we just here did the analysis comparing the coefficient that we determine, analyze different parts of the spectrums through the integral of these curves, and trying to give some notes. And depending on the note that that point shows, if we could distinguish that it was a normal or a carcinoma, depending of this kind of processing. And this note here we are present, of course, we have this had this evaluation in different parts of the spectrum, but the better one was this coefficient. And we put here a line trying to divide which is normal, which is carcinoma. Of course, we are going to have some intersection in this region, would be our false positive and false negative results. A very good diagnostic technique would be if we have these two regions completely divided, but separated. But it is almost impossible to have this. Another kind of processing that we performed for this same fluorescence spectra was doing the multivariate data analysis that used some programs, some statistical programs that you give all the data that you collect, all the spectra, and this kind of chemometric analysis try to find some patterns and try to find what is characteristic from one group and from another group, would be the normal and carcinoma group. And they do, these programs do a interspectral correlation. So they have a comparison between one spectrum and another one, and try to compare these both spectrum and find which what is really characteristic of a carcinoma. And so we compare these two kind of analysis. One would be the intraspect evaluation, the first one that I present, and the other one is just this statistics analysis for the multivariate data. But while we are trying to do here is to determine a fluorescence signature for the carcinoma, in this case, the tone carcinoma. And here, I'm just showing the best results that we had. compare the intra-spectral analysis, the first one, we have this level of sensitivity and specificity, and doing the multivariate data analysis, we have the best results here with the sensitivity of almost 96%. Only doing a kind of analysis that we have a response at real time and not having to perform some tissue removal or destroying this kind of tissue. Some results in patient. This is from Dr. Sokolov and Natalia from Russia. And there they combined two techniques, the image and also the spectroscopy. So here is they could detect a carcinoma in situ. And here is the evaluation at that white illumination. And here is the out fluorescence without any kind of drug here. And you see that the normal part of this tissue, they have a higher fluorescence, a green fluorescence. And the region that later they detect would be the carcinoma in situ, they, this tissue present decreased fluorescence in this green part, which was also confirmed by this fluorescence spectroscopy from these two regions. So this is would be the fluorescence spectroscopy from the normal tissue and this one from the cancer tissue. This is a patient of with a leukoplastic lesion, which can be a malignant lesion, a pre-malignant lesion. And we have here the clinical aspect of this leukoplastic lesion. And in two different regions, here at the heteromolar area and here at the thick mucosa. And in both graphs, we have with the blue line the normal comparison of a mucosa. We have here a higher intensity fluorescence in both regions. And the red line represents different points in these lesions. And we have here in some points only the intensity is different, but in some point we have here something different appearing. And also here we have a difference in light intensity in this kind of comparison. And changing a little bit of the fluorescence spectrum also. This is a system that we prepared for doing the analysis at clinical, because it's all compact and we can carry on a bag. So this is a system with two laser extension, one at 400 nanometers and the other 532 nanometers. And if you want to see this system, we are showing at our stand there, the university stand. And also we have a Y-type probe that at one end is connected to the laser and the other end is connected to this spectrometer. And this whole system is connected to a computer. And we have here the fluorescence. For each point, we have a spectrum. And we are just beginning a clinical study for pancreas cancer. And in this case, of course, you have to put the investigation probe in contact to the tissue. So it is performed in a surgical room, in a surgical procedure. But just because you have to have access to this probe. You can also use this kind of technique through any kind of scope. If you want to do this for esophagus or for bladder, for instance, you can do this. And now what's what is new for optical diagnosis, they are trying to find biomarkers connected to nanoparticles to go specifically what you want to detect, what you want to monitor. In this case, they were trying to evaluate the cardiac function, the heart function, and they have difference here on the distribution of these nanobiomarkers. So, of course, this is also false colors, but they can delimitate the part of the heart that it is sick or it is have some problem here just through using a biomarker and detecting the fluorescence. And also here, comparing if you have only the fluorescence and using a biomarker with quantum dots or with the nanoparticles, and you can evaluate different areas where these biomarkers is accumulate. So now they are trying to not only use the out fluorescence would be that would be only depending on the biological fluorophores, but also doing some kind of a target, specific target, and using the quantum dots to mark specifically what you want to find in that tissue. So probably from now on, they are going to use both techniques and comparing and trying to have results more with higher sensitivity and higher specificity. This is all our group that has been working with fluorescence in our laboratory, and also we have a good collaboration with Faculdade de Medicina, a medical school from Ribeirão Preto, and it is not a small group. We have a lot of students working in this problem. Thank you very much.